All right, guys, we are back with Big Matt for MPA, the real life with MPA, the Insights Cube, and we're in different location today, EOS Fitness on Lake Mead, because we just finished a killer workout with the four-time Olympia champ, Jay Cutler. How was that, Matt?
That was fun. I was happy that he was like a sport and wanted to try my training out. That was cool.
Yeah, you didn't think that was
going to be the
case?
I wasn't sure if he's going to be like, you know what, I don't want to push it, go to failure, I just want to get a pump. I was like, but he did. He was awesome.
I don't think you knew what to expect, to be honest with you. But you know what? I'm glad that's what you guys did, because I shoot with him all the time, and it's not to say it's always the same thing, but it was nice to see some different style of training.
That too. Yeah.
You know, I think it'll
it's
be interesting for people,
for viewers,
to see it. Yeah. So we're gonna do some Q&A, man.
Q&A time.
All right. So what do you got?
We're pulling this question out. So let's see what we got here, guys. All right. Baby JRR, he asked. Opinion on carb backloading to keep insulin sensitivity at its highest during the day and through training. I found this to work great for me, but want your opinion on it. I put muscle on easy and fat easy as well. So it's a balancing act for me to make sure I don't overdo the carbs. I'm sure if I added growth, it would slightly change the way I metabolize nutrients, stay leaner, but I have not made that jump yet. I feel this question can help guys like myself and others. So my opinion on carb backloading, which is basically, it's a diet protocol to where you stay carb free for about 3/4 of the day, so morning, afternoon, and then you train during the evening, maybe 6 to 7 p.m., and then you load all your carbohydrate allotment right in that post-workout window at night.
Wow.
Okay, so I've actually tried this diet. And the thing is, for me, I respond well with any diet because my metabolism, my genetics are pretty decent, so high fat, low carb, etc., I do pretty well. But for someone that is maybe endomorphic or big bone, puts on fat easy, thicker skin.
Like me.
Nah, you have veins everywhere, man. That might be a good approach because a lot of you guys that are endomorphic or huskier or thick skin, you have hunger issues to where it's hard for you to stay satiated on a diet. So instead of having 250 grams to 200 grams of carbs spaced out throughout the day, it might work better for you guys to just centralize it right in that post-workout window, so it's almost like you have a feast. It's still the same calories. You're still getting the 250 grams of carbs worth of calories, whether it's through the day or right in one shot, and then you get that something to look forward to, so that very well could work. However, I kind of have a little issue with the actual protocol of carb backloading, the way it's written in the book, because it's a marketing ploy. And the reason I say that is because the author tends to get you really overhyped about eating cherry turnovers, donuts, pizza, like junk food. And I think that's a selling point because, let's get real, if you have a bad metabolic rate and genetically you aren't that lean or you don't burn calories that well, I don't care who you are or how you organize your calories during the day, whether it's post-work, however, you're eating those fattening of foods, fat and sugar and junk food, calories in or calories out. You're gonna store fat if you're in a caloric surplus, right? But the way the author maps out the book, it's just like a really sexy, appealing type of marketing scheme. I think people buy into that. But if you actually want to do carb backloading in a really like strategic, meticulous way to where you lower your fat content and just keep fat in the beginning of the day without carbs, coconut oil could be okay for an energy source, raw almonds. And then after your workout, I would believe in something more along the line of low fat carbs. So not pizza, not cherry turnovers, rice cakes, even kids cereal that's low fat or fat free. So high sugar is fine, but I don't agree with the fat content. I really think that's a ploy to kind of get people to buy into it because it sounds like you're cheating every night. I don't think that's gonna present the best physique possible. It could work. Now it could work for someone that's completely eating like shit no matter what, so any shock or change is gonna elicit a result. But for a person that's already been dieting pretty strict and then they go to carb backloading with desserts post-workout and a bunch of junk, like churros, elephant ears, and donuts, it's not gonna work for you, buddy. But also you said to increase insulin sensitivity. Insulin sensitivity is going to increase as you lose body fat and as you expend more energy far as aerobics, anaerobic training with weight training. As you dump body fat, you'll gain sensitivity. And you could do that with higher carbs or low carbs, it just doesn't really matter. And another thing people need to understand is that certain fats, like saturated fats, can actually lower insulin sensitivity, increase resistance. So it also depends on the quality of fats that you implement in the diet as well. So omega-3 fats from fish oils increase sensitivity. Saturated fats, not so much. Red meat and even coconut oil to a certain extent. Some of it will actually not help with sensitivity. So it really just depends on the person. But like I said, it can work for you if you're the right body type and you have issues maybe with diligently eating carbs throughout the day and you just want to put in post-workout.
Awesome. Thank you. All right, Big Mac, what else you got?
Okay. Brooks Clark, he asked, when you were preparing for a national level shows, when you were gung-ho, did you reduce carbohydrate intake on rest days? And do you generally reduce carbs on rest days for your athletes? So Inside Scoop with MPA is all about honesty. And to be honest with you guys, I very seldomly took a rest day when I was preparing for national shows. A few reasons. I loved food, so I loved carbs. So like I felt like I wanted to have all my meals as normal because I just enjoyed being hungry and savoring the meals. So I worked out every day that I could.
Just so you could eat?
Yeah, just so I could eat. And of course, secondly, because I love working out. And I was at the point nationally that whenever I was working with my own business and I could dictate my own schedule, I was kind of living as a bodybuilder to where I can rest and recover and eat around the clock and not really be stressed out working like a 9-to-5. So I just love getting away and training. It was a stress reliever. It'd almost be more stressful not to train. I'm not saying that's the best way because I do believe in adequate rest. Obviously, your central nervous system takes a beating. I think back then, though, like Jay, I wasn't beating my CNS to the ground. I was kind of training high volume, and I wasn't going to, like, utmost failure. So I had more gas in the tank, so I could train every day. Now, I would take a day off, I'm sure, if I had to, whether it was usually because of an incident where I had to go somewhere, a family thing, or wasn't because I was actually being logical and thought I needed a day off, like, for my body. It just kind of happened. But as far as my athletes, yes, I do give them rest days. And then some athletes, I'll say, train 7 days a week and instinctively email me or message me and let me know, because you know your body, you know your brain and your fatigue levels, and we'll take a rest day or 2 or 3 days. You know, some people actually, I'll give them 2 or 3 days off in a row and it drives them crazy. I'll be like, listen, I want you to literally rest, take naps, keep your house like dark and dim, watch some movies, read, like literally just bedridden, take Epsom salt bath, like just lower your cortisol, lower your stress. And it drives them nuts, the thought of it. But if they actually abide by that, they feel like rejuvenated. And it's like, let's say someone does a 20-week prep and at 9 weeks out, I tell them to do that. What's 3 days out of 9 more weeks? Like, they'll only now have more fuel to hit it hard. It's 3 days. So it's like, it's really, we're all mental, us bodybuilders. So yeah, rest days definitely need to be taken in. And actually, to answer your question, I kind of went a little beyond that. Carbohydrates on rest days. Now, usually I will actually keep carbohydrates low because, like I mentioned, I have them literally resting and napping. And I kind of look at a rest day as if you're having protein and vegetables, hopefully with your metabolic rate, and maybe you are on fat burners, what have you, you're oxidizing body fat. You're even losing fat on rest days because you're so revved up with your muscle mass and whatever products you're on. Not doing carbs that day, you know, just at rest, your body oxidizes fat at a low heart rate. So that's my thought process. Now, some people could have carbohydrates on a rest day to refuel for the next workout, whether it's leg day or back day, and that's not a problem. And once again, it's a mental thing to where, oh my God, I'm pre-contest, I can't have carbs if I'm not active, I'll store fat. Reality check is that you aren't gonna store fat because you're having carbohydrates most likely in a low fat environment, and it's actually physiologically very hard for the carbohydrates to convert into triglycerides and store as fat. So if anything, if you have carbs, you'll just replenish glycogen. Worst case scenario, which is actually a good thing. But mentally, us bodybuilders, we think like that. So yeah, carbohydrates aren't a bad thing on off days, but me personally, I will have them eat protein only and vegetables.
Awesome. Thank you, guys. All right, Q&A with MPA. Go.
This question's from, I'm probably going to butcher it, Rem underscore Shadeller. Okay. I don't know. Whatever. He asks, best HGH protocol for off-season period, timing around training, meals, sleep, insulin, etc. I can't really say what the best protocol is. I don't think anyone can. It's all about your preference or your trial and error.
Yeah.
But I can tell you a few different options. So, and this is theory, so just take what I say with a grain of salt, like everything. I think for off-season, everyone's goal is to be the most muscular possible, to gain muscle tissue, right? Not so much like lose body fat like pre-contest. So in an off-season setting, you want IGF-1 levels to be high as possible, right? GH converts to IGF in the liver, then you have systemic IGF-1 elevated. Hopefully it reaches muscle cells, all that stuff. So intramuscular, not subcutaneous. Intramuscular is going to reach the serum levels and spike your blood serum higher and more abruptly than subcutaneous, right? So subcutaneous might be better for cutting or contest prep. So off-season, let's say you're on a budget. Growth hormone is very expensive, right? Let's say instead of taking 4 to 5 IUs every day, you take 8 to 10 IUs 3 times a week or every other day, right? So now you have a bigger bolus infrequently. And a bigger bolus is going to elicit a bigger response in IGF-1.
Mm.
More IGF-1 with more food calories. And you asked about insulin. If the person is taking insulin by chance, it's going to magnify the IGF-1 response with the growth hormone as well. You're going to have a lot of anabolism, a lot of anti-catabolic mechanisms going on too. I think possibly infrequent higher dose growth hormone during the week could be more beneficial for off-season for utmost muscle. Now, you probably will get more side effects, just obviously higher dose, IGF-1's higher, possibly more water retention, more carpal tunnel, more cellular water, whether it's extracellular and intracellular, you're gonna have more fullness, maybe more bloat, water retention in the face, but you're in off season and you're trying to maximize growth, right? So in a perfect world, you know, given your health's good, you can handle that stuff. Infrequent growth hormone usage, maybe every other day or 3 times a week in a bolus amount intramuscularly, right?
Mm.
Now timing, I'm not so big on timing because after a while, I think growth hormone works at the cellular level to where your IGF-1's elevated kind of chronically. But far as spiking blood serum levels, I would say maybe even pre-workout might be a good time because let's say you inject intramuscularly, right? Let's say your GH might peak in your blood around 2.5-3 hours post intramuscular injection. You work out for 1.5-2 hours. So right around that post workout, your IGF-1 is now elevated really high, right? So you timed it perfectly, high IGF. You're having your insulin then, your carbs, your protein, your aminos. Makes sense, theoretically. So my opinion, for sure, out of all the GH doses, however you split up the 8 to 10, a good amount needs to go pre-workout off-season.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's my opinion, right?
That's a good one. I've never heard that, actually. Okay, very cool. Thanks for that. I got a question for you, man, and it comes from an article that I actually read that you wrote a while ago, and I was telling my partner, my training partner, and Coach Eric about it, and it was the best article. It was an article you wrote about how to avoid rebounding too badly after a competition. Mm-hmm. And losing your shape and getting fat and watery and all stuff. Because I saw so many people have done it. Anybody who competed, especially for the first time, they look great on stage, and a week later, you can't even tell they competed. So take me through our article and just give the basic ground rules on what not to do so people don't actually ruin 4 months of prep.
Yeah, so, gosh, man, that's such a horrible dilemma that happens. And it always happens usually to like beginners, right?
yeah, of course.
And you know, I'll even sit them down like we're doing now, and I'll like literally try to like ingrain into their head like there's serious repercussions that can happen. Like if you're young, like 20 years old, 23, 24, like you're resilient, but it's like, man, as you get older, and you, maybe if you're a beginner and you start when you're like 35, 40, 45, bad things can happen.
I heard heart attacks.
Oh, heart attacks, yeah. There's something called, what is it? So hyperphagia, which is like the state of overeating or force feeding, basically. There was a study done, I think, long time ago. I don't know if it was like military from like either concentration camps where after people were rescued, they ingested copious amounts of food because their brain was so crazy from being starved that they didn't know when to stop, almost like a dog.
Yeah.
And they had like basically post-starvation hyperphagia, which is very similar to a reaction that can happen post-contest because you are doing a form of starvation.
Yeah.
Caloric restriction, low body fat levels, you're gaunt in the face, you're literally, your visceral fat, organ fat, omental fat is dissipated. You're ready to eat any and everything. So I guess these people overate so much that like literally a lot of them were having like heart failure, kidney failure. They were dying. There was like fatalities from the hyperphagia response from starvation camps or concentration camps.
Wow.
So that being said, a bodybuilder coming off of a show, you got to think like you also went through a rigorous 15, 16, 20 week prep and you might have partaken in products that also don't help your health as well, far as, you know, reducing your kidney function already. Maybe you had high blood pressure, you didn't check it, you're on stimulants, chronic high blood pressure, your blood vessels were restricted from the ephedrine, the clenbuterol, what have you. Maybe your blood was also thick at the same time, or viscous from boldenone or whatever, NPP or whatever you were taking.
Yeah.
All these things are very unhealthy. Now after the show, you go glutton mode, and you, and not only do you go glutton mode, but you came out of a contest, which most likely you use some form of water manipulation plus diuretics on top of water manipulation. So you could already get dry and dehydrated without diuretics. Now you put a actual prescription diuretic on top of that and you overshoot. Then you do the opposite. You go gung-ho wild with sodium laden fattening sugary foods. People oftentimes gain, I've seen 20 to even 40 pounds within a week, to where their ankles are literally about ready to, you could take a razor blade and bust open basically. You gotta think the undue stress you're putting on your kidneys, the undue stress you're putting on your heart, all the actual abdominal, the intra-abdominal water retention, the pressure within, restricting your heart, your blood is also, you gotta think of this, your blood is also thick going into the show with normal hydration. Now restrict water, take a diuretic, the blood turns into sludge. So you wanna bring up, like people bring up Andres Munzer, right? I don't think it was so much like exactly the crazy chemicals he was taking for as like anabolics. I think that he was so dry and shredded, plus he pushed maybe loop diuretics that were very harsh. It's a combination of coagulating like thick blood plus pulling all the water out of the plasma and blood makes it like sludge, like a gel, plus the elevation of him flying dehydrates you more. That's gonna cause failure, entire organ failure, everything's gonna fail. You can do something similar post-contest, guys. A lot of guys that bodybuild don't have that fed signal to where they actually have control. They literally will go hog wild. So it's really important to understand that there's a way to do it. And really, you gotta train yourself. You gotta really understand the ramifications. So by me telling you this, and you maybe researching and making logical sense about what could happen, you can kind of approach it differently. A lot of people that are young, like I was, you'll think it's funny. Like, oh, you'll press into your ankle and show it off and take an Instagram picture. You're cool, you're probably verge of kidney failure. And you're showing up, you don't know any better because you're young and dumb and you're rebound. Oh, I'm up 40 pounds, bro. My blood pressure is 220 over 120, right? So these are things that people need to consider, especially as you get older and you're a beginner and you're just getting into this. And I've even seen experienced people still repeat the same stupidity post-contest. So now what I do is post-contest, right? You definitely want to enjoy yourself to a certain extent. So you actually should map out what you're going to eat like right after the show. You win your overall, right? Your pro card or whatever, first place. You go celebrate with your family that night, okay? Drink water casually, not like crazy Gatorade gallon to make a watermelon in your stomach. Ingest water with your junk food. Next morning, whether you have a photo shoot or whatever, or you just, you know, go out with your family, have a breakfast of choice. So dinner, Saturday night, Sunday, breakfast of choice. After your breakfast of choice, start drinking water more and more and just do protein and vegetables to excrete. That night at dinner, Sunday night, have one more dinner with your family, okay? So Saturday dinner, Sunday breakfast, deplete Sunday, Sunday dinner, three meals. Now Monday, you're gonna go zero carb, high vegetables, protein, and jack up water. Now what's gonna happen? Probably around Tuesday, all the sodium retention and all the sodium that you ate and the sugar, and now you're drinking back to 2 gallons like pre-contest, it's gonna catch up to you about Tuesday night. You're gonna be a freaking sun face, can't see, but that's all going to hold it initially, then it's gonna start spilling and releasing, right? So you're gonna have a holding period. It's just homeostasis. Don't get discouraged by that. Don't eat more and get depressed. Keep pushing the water, keep pushing the carbs low, get the cardio up, the sweat. Tuesday you'll be at your peak bloat. By Thursday, you'll start pissing like a sieve. By Friday, you'll probably be dry again and vascular and crazy.
Wow.
Now you're back to that restart set point. Once you get to that homeostatic point to where you're kind of like how you were a week out, now you can start your off season with good quality food. Not junk food. Oh, but I want to have a junk meal at least once a day. It's like, no. You have that mindset. It's going to turn into twice a day, and you're going to be you might not be like unhealthy as far as the water retention as much because you got the homeostasis back, but now you're going to put on body fat faster than you'd ever want to put it on, because all that food in a surplus is going to store lower back, glutes, everything's going to get saturated again. And then by week three, you're going to be depressed.
Yeah.
You're going to be fatter than you were.
Yeah.
You're going to feel bloated. You're going to just like, all your work you did for 20 weeks will be gone in 2 to 3 weeks. And now you're going to have like just a mental fog to where then you're going to go, oh my God, I got to re-diet down again. I got to do a mini diet. Yeah. I got to, but now your body's so pissed and stubborn, it won't even drop fat. So now you're fat, watery, bloated, and now you go back on high cardio and low carbs, and you can't even lose the fat you just accrued. You're literally a depressed piece of crap. I'm just gonna be honest. So don't be a depressed piece of crap. Don't do that and then go, oh, Matt was right. Like, just do what I said, and once you get to that homeostatic set point of being normal, slowly build up your calories with the same food you dieted on. Oh, whenever you dieted 2 weeks out, that oatmeal was like heaven, right? Have a little more oatmeal. The rice was good, right? Have a little more rice. Why do you need to go out and have a bunch of junk or go to your, you know, with your friends that don't bodybuild, your random high school friends or whatever friends from years back and go eat Red Robin and
enablers,
Fuddruckers and all that stuff because you were so deprived for 20 weeks. I'm telling you guys, that temporary joy is not worth the side effects because you want to take advantage of your off season. That's one way to just blow. One of the best periods to grow quality is right then.
Awesome. And let's say you're not going into off-season mode. Let's say you do what you said, and then by Friday or Thursday, you're back to normal, and then you have another show in like 4 weeks, let's say. You just go back to your normal diet.
Oh, yeah. You know what's funny? Now, it's so funny the way the mind works. Once the switch is on, the switch knows. So like a person that has multiple shows, so let's say a person has a show in 3 weeks, I'll let them do the same thing. I'll have them have a meal Saturday, then 2 meals Sunday, then Monday they deplete. Sometimes those people actually just look better within a couple days. They're fuller, they're still lean, they're dry, because they know they got another show.
Yeah.
The people that don't have another show, maybe they cheat behind my back and something happens to where they just stay watery, they don't quite get back to normal.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe they're just not telling me, they're following everything 100%. But I noticed like from show to show when I would do it, and I had a show 3 weeks later, I would cheat the whole day Sunday, but then back to depletion, I was like looking crazy within 2 days.
Wow.
I was like, you know, everything was still there. You might get like a day of bloat.
Yeah.
So definitely with show to show, same thing. And maybe some people mentally can't do that. They just have a meal Saturday. Just Saturday and then right back on the grind Sunday.
It's okay.
You know? But a lot of people Sunday want to have a breakfast and pancakes. I totally understand that.
Yeah, I give myself 24 hours. Personally, usually will tell me, okay, the show is over Saturday night. Eat until Sunday midnight. That's it. Monday, back on the diet.
You can do a lot of damage if you give people like open reins to like all day just stuffing their face. I mean, that's why I try to do like just the meals spaced on Sunday.
Yeah.
But you know, once again, it comes down to genetic individuality. Whereas I was more, I had a grace period where I could stay lean and just fill out and not put on body fat as fast.
Yeah.
Whereas another guy could put on fat within like, it seems like a week.
Yeah.
And they ruin everything. So it does depend on the person. But
yeah.
I still think nonetheless, whether you're metabolically gifted, you still got to look at the internal health issues. Whether you look good physically, cosmetically, if you're ruining your kidneys by high blood pressure or something like that, then
it's all over.
Who cares how physically good you look, right?
That's so, right. That was a great question.
Yeah.
Great article. Thanks, Big Matt. Yep.